our King. Amen. Let's all stand together this morning. The divine, lost in our sin, you made us.
Heart to fear
like snow. The sun forbear to shine. But God, who called me below, will be forever mine. Will be forever. Sound beautiful, Hope. As we worship in song and we pour out our hearts, we also worship by taking communion. And at this time, the ushers will come forward and we will sing a song together. We encourage you to participate in communion how you feel comfortable, how God shaped you for worship. Please feel free to sit or stand or kneel or cry or sing. The belief in your heart that Jesus Christ gave his life for you, that he conquered death and he rose from the grave, and that you will live with him forever, is all the permission you need to participate in this family as a believer. We remember in communion as individual children and as a collective family of believers. And we reflect and we remember on our brother and our friend, our Savior and our King, Jesus.
Open my eyes, let me see.
together lovely, all together worthy, all together wonderful to me. Amen. At this time, we'll release our children for Sunday school.
Hey, Hope Church, are you glad to be here today? Amen. So great to have you here at our worship celebration. We celebrate. This isn't a funeral. Tomb is empty. And so we celebrate God when we come together and enjoy one another in fellowship. We have lots of visitors today. It's so awesome. We've been through that fire. We've been through that pandemic. We don't know how to quit. And to be growing again is just an awesome thing. Whether you're a part of us in person here or online, we are one church, and we thank you for joining us. Let's give it up for our band, our worship team, Hope Rising. We're so blessed by our musicians and our tech team and our Sunday crew. You may have noticed if you were here last week, I didn't use a lot of Bible verses. I typically use a little bit more Bible. And if you went out going, wow, I thought they like believed in the Bible. Hang on, okay? Because I'm doing 2 weeks that are kind of introductions in this series called Who Needs God? And we talk about it in our small groups. I loved my small group discussion this past week. And we had one verse, but we talked about these concepts we're looking at. And the point of this series is it's heartbreaking to me that people are leaving religion and many are leaving Christianity. And I don't believe it's necessary. And I think that some people are believing a God that really doesn't exist. They're leaving a version that was presented to them, the New American Version. I'm not talking about the New American Translation, but the version of Christianity. And I'm begging people in the sound of my voice, whether you're in person and you've stopped believing or you're not sure or you're starting to struggle, whether you're online listening, there's a growing population called the nuns, not Catholic nuns, but the nuns, I don't have none. I don't have any faith. I don't have any affiliation. Some still say they believe in God. Some struggle with that. And I just want to say to you, maybe you need to give it another chance. Maybe the Jesus you left was too fragile and to be of any help. And I'm praying in this series people will re-examine. And religious doubts are not something that a few people have. So don't feel embarrassed if you're struggling with some doubts. True things can leave us wondering or unsettled. So it makes sense that many in our technically, scientifically advanced world move sometimes to the middle. Some are saying, I'm not sure I want that religion thing. But then on the other hand, I don't want to go to the extreme where it's all about biology. I'm a chunk of matter floating around randomly, just made up of biology with no purpose. I'm not a real thing, we talked about last week. No mind. Everything's already predetermined, although people who say they believe that still check both ways before they cross the street. And some don't want to go one extreme or the other, so they're stuck in the middle. They feel stuck in the middle. That's a part of our culture right now, a growing part. Don't be embarrassed. Humanity has been disbelieving in God since the beginning. there was a time when the most sophisticated civilization of its time, the Egyptians, worshipped Ra, the sun god. There was a time when the most sophisticated civilization worshipped Zeus. There was a time when the most sophisticated civilization of its time, Rome, worshipped Jupiter, and then ultimately even declared deified Caesar. One writer, Dawkins, writes, "We are all atheists about most of the gods that humanity has ever believed in. Some of us just got one god further." And that's what he believes. Early Christians, this is interesting, early Christians were considered atheists by their cultures. When they would not worship Caesar as Lord and were walked into arenas, people yelled out, "Down with the atheists." But the message of the early Christian to the pagans, the unbelievers, was, "No, you just got the wrong God. You have the wrong God. We're not atheists. You have the wrong God." And I believe that problem still persists. I don't want to be arrogant or condescending, but just in my journey, I know the God that I believe in now is different than the God I believed growing up. And there's kind of a Sunday school God we can get. There's a childlike faith we can develop. But when we become adults, we ask adult questions sometimes, and some people get childlike answers or just faith-based answers to fact-based questions, and so they leave. And the stories aren't really true Christianity that we sometimes hear growing up. In some regions of our country, 25% of the people consider themselves irreligious, and most of those were church attendees at one time. And something happened. They quit believing. And when you look at most deconversion stories, that's people who were converted or came to Christ, and then they left. When you look at their stories, you see some things in common. Sometimes they grew up in religious environments, like some of us. And then they experienced this childhood conversion. And then they transitioned to an irreligious environment, and they liked it. They went to a place where it wasn't so religious. It may have been they went to college. It may be they moved to a different place and they weren't surrounded by religious people and they liked it better. And then some went to college and asked those adult questions as they were studying different things in the world, and they got they had this childhood faith that they had inherited, and they received faith-based answers to fact-based questions. As one author said, "One day it dawned on me I didn't believe anymore." Maybe you were driving in your car from somewhere and it hit you, or you were combing your hair, or you were just going for a walk and it hit you, "I don't believe anymore. I'm not sure I believe." And deconverted Christians usually abandon, "I believe, a non-existent God, and the Bible tells me so, Jesus." There's a couple of versions we're going to look at this week and next week. One version is the "somebody told me so" God. So people believe what they've been told by their parents or by pastors or priests or teachers, and they adopt their faith based on what they've been told by people. And sometimes we're told the wrong versions. And so they get tired of that and they step away of what they've been told over and over. Others, it's "a Bible tells me so, Jesus." And that's kind of the Sunday school version. And the Bible says it, the Bible says it, the Bible says it. And I'm going to get into that one next week. May upset a few people, but I hope you'll be here anyway. We're going to look at it. Karen Armstrong sums up the problem of the "somebody tells me so" God. She's a British author who went from being a Catholic nun to the other kind of nun I was telling you about, non-affiliated, written all kinds of books and comparative religions, not just Christianity, but Islam and other faiths, now has some kind of mystical faith. I don't know how to explain it. You could find it somewhere in a book, but she does make a good statement here about this. She says, "Many of us have been left stranded with an incoherent concept of God. We learned about God about the same time we learned about Santa Claus. But while our understanding of Santa Claus phenomenon evolved and matured, our theology remained somewhat infantile. Not surprisingly, when we attained intellectual maturity, many of us rejected the God we have inherited and denied that he existed. But when you hear some people describe the gods they no longer believe in, you might think, I don't believe in that God either. That God doesn't exist. The God you quit believing in wasn't worth believing in. Who is that? Andy Stanley talks about six gods we grew up with. Hey, I think he stole one or two from somebody else, but most of these he talks about. One is the bodyguard God. These are the gods of No Testament. That's the title of our message today, the gods of No Testament. The bodyguard God, and this is the God that doesn't allow bad things to happen to good, innocent people. No one has ever built a case for God based on the lack of evil in the world. This is a thought from childhood that God cares about you, and he does. I believe that he's a loving God, but you're taught to believe that nothing bad will happen to you sometimes. That would be like someone declaring you don't believe in the iPhone having a creator because there are many broken iPhones in the world. Pain is not a rational reason not to believe in God, but it is an emotional reason not to. And we can be hurting emotionally and make decisions that are not rational. And for this to be an argument against the existence of God, one must assume that the following argument for the existence of God is this: a good God would not allow bad things to happen to good people. Since bad things never happen to good people, there must be a good God. This is not a Christian argument. So bad things do happen to good people, and it's not a gotcha against our faith when bad things happen to good people, because our movement began with our leader suffering horribly, and he's the best person that ever lived. So it's a lie, this God of the God that protects you, the bodyguard guide, where you never go through any pain or disappointment. And the problem with this real world is we do go through some pain or disappointment. And some of God's strongest believers go through pain and disappointment. And I have a personal belief there's things that happen in this world that you'll never be the same. I've tried to change my vocabulary from did they get over it, because I believe there's some things we never get over, but we get through it. And God doesn't give us all the answers, but he gives us his presence. In Isaiah, he said, I will go with you when you go through the waters. Amen. So saying, hey, there's bad things happen, then there must not be a God. The leaders of our movement, not just Jesus, the leaders suffered horrible things. And then they didn't say, well, there must not be a God. Second God, that's the on-demand God. And that may sound funny, but we act like that sometimes. The on-demand God is always responsible to the fair and selfless requests that I make. I want him to respond the way I think he should respond. And, you know, sometimes I may not even be asking for something big. Like, you know, God, could I get a date here? I don't need a date, but I'm just saying, you know, you may be asking that. I've got grandkids. I'm good. But, we have this expectation that if there's a God who's all powerful, then my request makes sense, and so he should grant what I'm asking here. But I bet you can think at times you're glad he didn't answer the way you asked. You'd be married to somebody you don't want to be married to, maybe, from a prayer in junior high or something, you know. A good God will respond to every sincere and selfless request. Since God always responds to sincere and selfless requests, God exists. That's a bad argument. Who told you God always responds the way you expect? He doesn't exist. Then there is the boyfriend God. or you could call it the girlfriend God. This is the God whose presence is always there, and you always feel his presence. And since I don't feel his presence, then he must not be present, with that logic. Said who? And some of us, we went to camp, and we got the warm fuzzies, and we sang under the stars, and we just felt it. But then you go through times in your life, you're not feeling it. Mother Teresa, who served the gutters of Calcutta, confessed that she sometimes didn't feel God, and she was serving the worst of humanity because she believed she wasn't feeling it, but she believed it. And she saw a Jesus who suffered terribly and was a homeless, starving person, and she wanted to serve those kind of people like Jesus was. I feel things sometimes from a burrito, piece of pizza. Don't go by your feelings. Sometimes you got to claim what you know. I think God lets us go through wilderness times sometimes, and we're not feeling it. But you got to, that doesn't mean he's not there. You know, things that are true and the most constant, sometimes we're the least aware of. You ever look at somebody and say, boy, the temperature in here is just perfect today. We don't really notice it unless it's too hot in here or too cold in here, right? You know, but it's real. You ever wake up and go, boy, I feel like an American today. Yeah, there's things that are true whether we feel it or not. And so that's a bad argument. And if you've been taught this, that it's all about the feelings and the hoochie-gilly feelings and then you're not feeling and you left, I don't blame you. I don't believe in that God either. Then there's the guilt God. Oh, this is a rough one. Some of us learn the guilt God. And you're not reading your Bible enough, and you're not going to church enough, and you're doing these things because you don't want to go to hell. I want to go to church because I don't want to go to hell. I want to reach out to people because I don't want to go to hell. I want to be nice because I don't want to go to hell. It's very fear-driven. Some of us had a Christian in our relationship who perpetuated that conditional love and that judgment. And so we projected it on Father God and say, that's what God, this is a tough one to get rid of. Can I get an amen? Can anybody testify? Yeah, this is a hard one to get rid of. You know why? We fall short. We're human beings. We make mistakes. And so if we have this God that's the guilt God, we're in trouble, and he's ready to zap us anytime. He's going to throw a lightning bolt down and zap me if I don't get it right. You know, and there's things like if it's enjoyable, oh no, you can't enjoy yourself as a Christian. If it's sexual, no, no, no. You know, God didn't create us to have any fun. He's a strict, conditional God. It's never enough, no matter what you do or you don't do. And if you ever get away from the guilt, God, congratulations. It's so good. Free at last. Free at last. And we're not saved by good works. We're saved to do good works, but we never get ourselves good enough to earn our way. And you don't have to try to earn your way. It's by faith. If you've been living with the guilt, God, get free of that, please. Get free of that. Then there's the anti-science God, where you have to choose, you're made to feel that way, that you have to choose between the undeniable science or unreliable religion. There are people who said, you know, I don't want to do this blood transfusion that science says I need because I got faith. Just where's your faith? Just have faith in God. And quit thinking, just have faith. And ignore what is undeniable and embrace what is unreliable. Stop asking all these questions. Just believe. You can be made guilty if you ask questions. Richard Dawkins says, one of the truly bad effects of religion is that it teaches us that it is a virtue to be satisfied with not understanding. We don't have to know. We just need to believe, in other words. I'm against that religion as well. You may have been taught growing up in that God and science are an alternative. Don't go to the doctor and practice this. You know, where you go, maybe you got a kid that you're really worried about and they're sick and you get a blood test and you're waiting on that test and you can't wait and you're sitting by the phone, you know. And you're waiting for the phone, and you're waiting for the report. And they finally call you, and they go, we have the result. And you go, what is it? And they go, well, God's just trying to speak to you. You don't want that answer. You want a natural, you want an answer from their medical training, in the natural world to give you wise advice on what to do with your kid. If you had to choose between God and who rejects scientific discoveries or choose science alone, no wonder you lost your faith. There are rational explanations, and there are things that we learn and we know now we didn't know before. That was there, and we don't have to make a choice. That comes to the gap God. These are related, the gap God, as opposed to the American Eagle or the Abercrombie God. I couldn't really say that one. God conveniently shows up in the gap God as an explanation for everything we can't currently explain. Well, that's God. It's just a God deal. Pull in the parking lot. Parking lot's packed. Pull up there. All of a sudden, someone backs up close to the entrance. Thank you, God. Well, I don't know. I don't know. And we attribute everything to God. Ancient people attributed everything to God. Bad weather, God's mad. Lower crops, God's unhappy with us. We got to sacrifice somebody, you know. And so ancient people attributed everything to God. And I have made a statement through the years when I study with people. When I talk about the Trinity, three persons, one God, and things about God, there's things I don't understand. And there's a part of me that likes having a God that's beyond me. On the other hand, I don't mean by that, stop asking questions. Just check your brain out, you know. Just follow blindly. Here, drink some Kool-Aid. It's, you know, God gave us a brain for a reason. And this undermines faith. Why? The list of can't explain is getting shorter and shorter all the time. But that's good. Unexplainable today may be explainable tomorrow. Could you imagine if Abram and Sarah got on an airplane? Now they'd be freaking out. You know, things have been discovered through time. And don't you want more cures for diseases? Of course you do. And so we want people to keep learning. And we Christians, we've got to be careful here that we just don't try to keep learning and encourage that. The unexplainable is not evidence for the existence of God. The unexplainable, in most cases, is the evidence of our ignorance. And I don't mean ignorance as a cut down. I mean its truest definition, lack of knowledge. One writer says, we must pay attention to the frontiers of our ignorance. You know, things like figuring out cancer, horrible things that are happening. I remember I was working in San Francisco when we started hearing about HIV/AIDS, and that was a scary thing, and we were very ignorant a lot about it. And now, and it looked like there was nothing that could be done, but they have discovered things that are helping humanity. And we have to keep paying attention to the front. That doesn't mean we don't believe in God. I have a dear friend who, it was a couple when I worked in Silicon Valley, and their company, their startup went public, and they became very wealthy overnight. And the wife said to me one time in my Bible study, my Wednesday noon Bible study, she said, Stan, you know, everybody talks about what man is inventing and what we're inventing. We're really not inventing it. We're discovering what is already there. God had it already there. And so it's not wrong. You shouldn't feel bad about asking questions. The answer is not always God did this or God did that. The God who is only credited for the unusual, coincidental, and unexplainable may not be needed. As we fly through space at 60,000 miles an hour in the Goldilocks zone, you know the Goldilocks zone, where you're not too close, just close enough to be warm, and you're not too far away where you freeze. Help me now, you are just right. You're at the right place. How in the world did we get just at the right place, the perfect distance? And many who have left religion left the God of the gaps. I don't agree in that God either. If God created the predictable, natural order, we should expect God to do things naturally in his creation, in the laws that he put in place. The God who's responsible only for things we can't explain does not exist. If everything were explained and explainable, it would not explain away our God. To believe in the God that is unnecessarily to pit yourself against science. As soon as science comes up with an explanation, you take God out of that box and you insert science. The problem is you shrunk God to Zeus or Jupiter or Ra to Mars. Simple explanation for things we don't understand. When Newton concluded gravity existed, he didn't say, well, we don't need God there. He concluded, oh, so that's how he does it. Here's why it's not the unexplainable that points to God. It's the mundane, taken for granted, but extraordinary regularities that point to God. If God created the universe instantly, And it says after he created in the creation story, what did God do? He rested. Sounds like he put an order in place. A cosmos, a order with laws in physics and biology and science. And when you're told you can't believe in any of that, you're being told the wrong kind of God. Did you know Christians launched the modern science movement based on the assumption of a predictive, orderly universe? It birthed modern science. God rested and set an order. There was no point in trying to understand a world that was the whims of the gods. There is no science apart from the recognizable laws of logic, nature, physics, and constants. Science doesn't try to explain where those originated. Theists believe God put them into place like breadcrumbs to lead back to him. So the God of no testaments, the bodyguard, the on-demand God, the boyfriend God, the guilt God, the anti-science God, the gap God, they're not true gods. You need to stop believing in them. Or if you already have, you shouldn't feel guilty. It's like Cupid. Some of y'all may still think Cupid's real. Cupid ain't real, you know. And so you don't have to worry about that. And you shouldn't feel guilty about not believing in those no testament gods. These are a combination, I believe, of unmet expectations, childhood explanations, ill-informed interpretations, and sometimes, sadly, blatant manipulation, where people have been manipulated by false religion. These are not good reasons to question the existence of God, but these are why people quit believing. Bad things happen to good people are not reasons to conclude that God doesn't exist. Where do babies come from? Oh, babies come from mommy's tummy. Oh. A little bit later in life, you get a different answer for where babies come from. Maybe as a teenager, a little older. And then maybe in a pre-med lab, you get a whole different answer on where babies come from. But you don't say, well, I'm going to quit believing in childbirth because, I was told that they come from mommy's tummy. We accommodate to the different capacities as we grow. It's the same spiritually. As you grow, you get to learn all your life. And I used to teach my kids when they went off to college, truth has nothing to fear. Don't check your brain out. At some point, mommy's tummy isn't enough of an answer. But we don't abandon the belief about birth. And you outgrew a God, maybe you left and you walked away, then you may have walked away unnecessarily. And what I'm trying to do with this series, and I know maybe some of you are sitting, I got faith, why am I hearing this? You have somebody in your family that's struggling. And it's a part, and the age of the nuns that I talked about last week that have no affiliation. Some don't necessarily say they don't believe in God, but they don't want to be affiliated with it. The average age was 36, but it's dropping. So kids younger and younger are abandoning faith. So that's why I'm doing this, because I love people. I want to reach people. I want to be a church where I don't just say, just believe, just believe. I want to figure out how in the world can we reach just one more. Today's not this big argument to convince you for God as much as I'm suggesting for you to think about what did you walk away if you walked away, because maybe you didn't have to. A somebody told me so God, and nobody needs that kind of God. Next week, it's going to be a little disturbingly liberating when we talk about the Bible tells me so, Jesus loves me version. Right now, think about the possibility of a God outside the box. Could it be like the early church believed before there was a New Testament? Years before it was a formed Bible, they believed, they died believing there was a God that loved the world so much that he sent his son to bring people into a relationship with him, a God of love, a God of order, a God of design that designed our amazing, awesome universe and our cosmos and our body. Can you believe our skin? You get a cut and it heals itself. How in the world? Where did that come from? I believe it came from, is it possible it came from a great designer instead of random just happened? I lost a dear friend this week, Marty Trujillo. My last conversation with him on Messenger, he called me big brother. I call him little brother. And he was a youth pastor where I was an outreach minister in Oklahoma City. And we were so close. He was so full of life. He came from a broken home. He was loved. His mom got him going to church. He became a believer at the school where my Bible school was. And then he ended up at the university I went to in Oklahoma. And then we were on staff together. They had a gym in that church. Isn't that awesome? And we would go every day at lunch and we played our version of basketball. It was kind of like football basketball or football wrestling basketball, you know, and one of us would be jumping up to make a shot and the other would go wham, and we would just laugh, and sometimes we fell on the ground laughing, just covered in sweat. And he was a tiger. He was a preacher. He became a preacher in a church in Colorado, big family, grandkids. He was a beekeeper, and there's pictures of him. He's teaching all these kids, holding up honey and teaching them about that whole process. Well, he passed away last week, and the family's really hurting, although I watched this morning one of his last sermons, and he was preaching about, we got hope. We are winners. The old thing falls off, but inwardly we're renewed day by day. And so he's gone to his reward. And he had an adopted daughter, Sarah, who posted this morning. She said, 24 years ago, I was adopted into the greatest family. During this hard time, I haven't had the right words. But Brett, that's her husband, had the perfect words in a recent sermon. And this is what her husband said Few weeks ago. Some of you know Sarah was adopted, and a lot of you know Marty Trujillo is her father. There's no genetic connection. There's a stronger connection. Her father and mother chose her. What a wonderful thing to be chosen. A lot of people don't realize Sarah was adopted because she fits so well in the family and the family fits her so well. But once in a while, people notice her maiden name is very Spanish, which doesn't fit her blonde hair and blue eyes. But it's easy to forget because of what Sarah says and does. Since Marty is her father in the truest sense of the word, Sarah has his way of saying and doing things. Sarah has her own mind, but her mind has been deeply shaped by her father. Her mannerisms, her words, the way she lives life can all be traced back to who her father is. The God of the New Testament, not the New Testament, is not like the gods of the New Testament. He's not a guilt trip God. He's a God of grace. And you can keep learning and learning all your journey and abandon any false versions. And we know he loves us. He loves you deeply. He sent his son for us, and he set us free. You're not a random chunk of matter floating around the universe with no purpose. He's got purpose in everything he creates is what we believe. And he brings you, he chooses you when you choose to be of the chosen. When you elect to be of the elect, he chooses you to take you home to be his son or daughter. Babies were abandoned on the temple steps in the ancient times. And every now and then somebody would come by and say, even a kid with a flaw, sometimes a little flaw, they just put that poor kid on those steps, leave it to die. And someone would walk by sometimes and say, I'm going to take you home. You're going to become part of my family. And that's what God did for us with all our flaws and all our wrinkles. This infinite God is a very personal God, and he chose us, and you are a child of God. Amen?
Amen.
Let's pray together. Father, thank you for your amazing word. But Lord, religion has struggled through the centuries, and we don't want to represent a false religion. We don't want to manipulate people. We want to share your love. So help us to have the courage to let go of things we may have grown up with. I pray for anyone here, God, that's struggling with their faith, that you stir their faith up, stir their hearts up, God, to think about the real Jesus who's not fragile, to think about the one true God, Lord. Stir it up like the man who said to Jesus, I want to believe. Help my unbelief. God, would you do that? Would you help anyone who's doubting? Help them not to feel beaten up and feel condemned by any of us, to feel loved and understood, God, and create faith. We're not going to back off of studying and learning all our lives. In Jesus' name, amen.
Yes.
Hey, let's stand and worship God.
Who am I that the highest King would welcome me? I was lost, but he brought me in. Oh, his love for me. Oh, his love for me. Who the sun sets free. Oh, with free indeed. I'm a child.
us your children, for making a way for us to come to you, for preparing a place for us, God.
I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who you say I am.
Let's declare that today.
I am chosen.
Children.
Amen. Thank you. Thank you. Let's give it up one more time for the band. Thank you. Thanks, guys. Awesome. Awesome. Well, Gina, we got Rock the Ridge coming up.
Yes, Rock the Ridge 20.
Yes, I can't believe it's 20. We began it in 2010. Rock the Ridge is a music festival for all ages, providing fun for all ages while benefiting a need on the Ridge. We've given to secular causes, school, different things, VA through the years. And it was started with the idea, people think Christians just want to get in your pocket. Church is about, I want to get in your pocket all the time. What if we did something and gave money away?
That's right.
And Jesus said things like, do good just because it's good. Jesus taught, don't just invite people over because you want them to invite you over. And so that's kind of the secret or the thing that we began with. Just do good because it's good. Couldn't afford to do it. We go in the red every time, and somehow it's covered. God comes through every single time. This is our 20th one. This is no time to shrink back and quit stepping out in faith. Amen?
Amen.
And that's a good time, exciting time. So I hope you'll come. If you have any questions, see me, see the board. I'm talking too much. Anything else you want to say about it?
There are a number of different ways that you can serve. Most things are in 1 hour slots, okay? So don't think if you sign up, you're going to be serving all day. We want you to enjoy. So check it out. We've got a snow cone booth. We have popcorn and food to be served and bounce houses to be looked over and all kinds of things to do. So we really hope that each of you will find a spot that fits your shape and that you'll join us in serving our community.
Yeah.
June 3rd.
June
Mark
3rd,
your calendars.
3 to 9.
3 to 9.
5 bands, secular and Christian bands. 2 groups that typically don't work together. When I first started, they were like, I don't know. Now they call us to play because it works. It's a beautiful combination.
It's a great time.
So, yeah.
Bring a dancing shoes.
You can read about small groups in the back. They're also on the ministry table and other things going on. Now it's time to pray for our offering. I don't know. Where's hope at? Now it's time to pray for our offering. Let's pray. Father, I love making a big deal about giving because you do. You so love that you gave. And you didn't put us here to just put everything in a can and sit on the can. You gave us blessings to use to bless others. This gift that we give through worship is just a reflection. Everything is yours. Please continue to make us a force of hope on the ridge and beyond that brings you glory. That's all we want. In Jesus' name, amen. Hey, before we celebrate with our last song and give, what is our purpose? Building relationships that last forever. How do we do that? Love God, love people. So remember, every single day this week, in Christ, we always have hope. Thanks for being here.
Let's all stand together.
Good.
If you would like personal prayer, please come forward and see our prayer warriors. We hope you have a wonderful week. We love you very much.